Welcome back to Biggie Outdoors at the top of the hour. We welcome in those just tuning in, and for those of you who have been listening, we're headed into another great hour of outdoor radio with Biggie and Brandon here at Biggie Outdoor Studios. This hour is brought to you by one of our great supporters at Outdoor Edge Knives and Cutlery, makers of the swing blade and other great tools for the outdoorsman. Check them out at OutdoorEdge.com and get yourself one of the best hunting knives or cutlery sets you'll ever own. Also buy Koala Buck Coolers, portable walk-in coolers for the sportsman, a great way to save your game when you're traveling on a hunt and want to keep your meat cool. Find them online at koalabuck.com. Now, stay tuned for more Biggie Outdoor Radio. Biggie Outdoors, located at Cedar Creek, is reopening its doors soon after its new remodeling. Home to the area's first and only big game hunting museum, with educational exhibits displaying animals from around the world and facts around the hunters' contributions to their survival. Pick up some unique souvenirs and gifts from the museum and from the Big E TV shows. Meet the pro staff from Big E TV and Big E Outdoor Radio. A great place to stop in with the whole family. And while you're there, book your next hunting trip with the Big E Outdoors professional hunters. With over 21 personal hunting destinations worldwide, you'll be sure to find a quality getaway with the Biggie Outdoors destinations. Biggie Outdoors is also home to Adrenaline High Geographic. Check us out online at BiggieOutfitters.com and register to win a free hunt. Biggie Outdoors at Cedar Creek. Hey, welcome back. Biggie Outdoor Radio here at the top of a new hour.
Yeah.
Hey, Brandon, the 17th, which was yesterday, was a busy day down in Madison.
Yep.
They got all kinds of new laws that are being looked at down there. I don't know what the outcomes of them were just yet, but one was being looked at was the bill to kill the back tag. The requirement to wear the back tag. Remember, we talked about that here a couple weeks back.
Yeah.
There's a law enforcement perspective. Wardens say the back tag number is occasionally a component of potential law violations, either reported to law enforcement by citizens. We just talked about it a second ago with how to identify your trespassers.
Yeah.
So they've been required to wear the back tag in Wisconsin since 1942.
It's a long time.
That's a long time.
Yeah. World War II.
The fiscal estimate noted that eliminating the back tags would save the DNR about $55,400 in printing and administration costs. But it says the average revenue gained from duplicate back tags in the past 3 years is about $98,000. And I don't understand if they're thinking that. So I don't know the way it looks. It looks to me like they're making $40,000. So I mean, if they're making money on it, why would you want to? Then saying that, hey, we're going to save money on this deal that's definitely not an argument. And right now we need all the money in our conservation fund that we can, because we definitely do need game wardens.
We do, yeah.
You know, yeah. I'm thinking that probably the game warden.
If we don't have game wardens, who are we going to pick on?
That's right.
Yeah.
And remember, we do pick on them on this show, but
we need them.
We do need them, and they are out there risking their lives. Here's the thing. I'm not downplaying a police officer or anybody like that, but everybody that the game warden comes in contact with has a weapon.
Yeah.
As even a fisherman has a knife. So game wardens have a pretty inherently dangerous job.
They do.
You know, they really do. And so you got to give them credit. They're out there doing a pretty dangerous job every day. Pretty stressful during the deer season.
Yeah. So why not keep up with the back tag? You know, honestly, my opinion, the back tag doesn't hurt anything. It's hanging on your back. It's out of the way. It's not hurting anything. The only time where I'm opposed to a back tag is if the weather warms up and I take my jacket off and I forget to move my back tag to the shirt that I'm wearing underneath. Well, you know, you just got to remember that. But honestly, it's not hurting anything. Why get rid of it? It's a Wisconsin tradition. There's people that come hunting in Wisconsin and take their back tag home with them, and that's part of their trophy. They want to keep that back tag. Hey, I hunted in Wisconsin. Here's my back tag.
Right.
Here's a couple of, before we get on to some of the new ones that were in on the 17th, which is yesterday, there's a couple other bills that were signed into law by Scott Walker on November 11th. Act 97 expanded the list of medical professionals who make disability determinations for disabled hunting and fishing. So this is the people that can decide if you're disabled enough to get your disabled tags and permits and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now it can be physician's assistants, PAs, and advanced nurse practitioners or practice nurse prescribers. So it would be your nurse practitioners and people like that. So if they're actually practicing in a physician's role,
yeah,
they can make those determinations now, which is actually good because when you really think about it, in a lot of these clinics, it's all PAs and NPs anyway. It's all nurse practitioners and physician's assistants that are doing it because the doctors are going into the specialty field now. And, you know, when you go to your family practices and your family doctors and stuff, there's not very many doctors that are doing that anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a good thing. Then Act 98 expands the list of those who can receive and transfer the Class A bear, spring turkey,
fall turkey also.
All fall turkey. Yep. Bobcat, Fisher, Otter, Wolf, if it gets delisted. Sturgeon, Spearing, and all that. The person that can transfer that stuff from one hunter to another.
It adds Class A, B, C, and D disabled hunters to the list of recipients for all seven of those approvals, as well as Purple Heart and active duty members of the armed forces for a Class A bear.
Yeah, so I guess we're going to have to check on exactly what that law is, but it actually, whatever it does, it must mean where you can transfer from one hunter to another. I didn't know you actually could transfer a tag, a Class A bear tag, from one hunter to another.
Yeah, actually a couple of, like a year ago or 2 years ago or something like that, a friend of ours had a tag transferred to his 10-year-old son, and he was able to take his first bear up in Ladysmith.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's. I knew they could transfer, but I didn't know there was limitations to it.
Yeah, and it says on the Wolf pending federal delisting, so they must be still working on that and hoping that gets
hopefully delisted. It gets delisted because it's getting out of control as we speak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which we've already talked about two different incidents where people have been attacked by wolves. So, you know, in one area only. And then the gun deer season has just started. So now,
I can't wait to see what comes out of this after our rifle season. You know, how many wolf encounters there are, and
how many people shoot their deer, and when they go back to find it, the wolves already have it.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I'm sure that's going to be.
It's going to happen.
Yeah. A couple more laws that were considered yesterday is the no minimum age bill.
Mm-hmm. And we say yesterday, folks, because this is actually, we pre-recorded this show. That way we can go out and do a little bit of hunting of our own.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's
so,
right.
Yeah.
So we are into the, as you're listening to the show, we are in the second day of the rifle season.
Yes. Yeah.
So if you're in your stand and you got your earbuds in, you can listen to this. Or if you're sitting in your truck, which is where Brandon and I like to hunt from, as it's nice and warm, we sit in the truck and have the windows up. But anyhow, but we are actually pre-recording the show. But there is a no minimum age bill that went into public hearing on November 17th. So it would eliminate Wisconsin's minimum hunting age and allow a mentor to also carry a firearm or crossbow or bow while mentoring the beginner. I guess what happens there now is it's going to allow the the minimum age is going to allow.
Because what is it now, 10?
It's 10, yes. Yeah. But it allows the mentor to decide whether the child is old enough. I think that if they're going to do that, what they should do is they should make it then mandatory that the child has to fill his own tag.
Yeah.
Because it'd be too easy for some guy to say, oh, I'm taking my 4-year-old hunting.
Yeah. I'm taking him hunting, and I'm able to carry my own firearm now. So.
Or you're going to have to prove that that child you're mentoring can actually fire the weapon.
Yeah.
Effectively. Because I can see a lot of guys taking advantage of this.
Yeah, this is going to open up some new conversations if this gets passed. And, you know, as we get to around to Sunday morning, as you're listening to this, you probably already know the answers to these, but this is only the day after for us.
Maybe they won't actually release it. But you know,
it's a touchy subject.
It's touchy, but you know. And then the other thing is the part where, you know, the second part of the bill that allows the mentor to also carry a weapon. Well, you know, when you start getting under 10 years old and these kids are, now you're wanting the kid to, you're gonna have that situation where you're asking the kid to carry the gun and you're carrying one, or the situation where the guy says, oh, well, you got a gun, you sit here, I'm going to go take a walk through the woods. I mean, I think you're asking for accidents. I think it should stay that.
Well, I don't think
if you're under 12 years old, only one weapon.
I don't think it's going to be something where the mentor is allowed to walk away from the child, because I think, what was it? I mean, back when I got my license, I had to have somebody sitting with me until I was 14. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think that still is the same.
Well, that's fine, and that should be. But
and there are going to be people that stretch those limits. There are.
Right.
I mean, there's always people pushing boundaries.
They do need to put some boundaries on that, because like it says right here, you know, it's going to allow parents and legal guardians to decide if their child is physically, mentally, and emotionally ready to handle a firearm, crossbow, or bow. You know, and like I said, you're going to get guys that are going to stretch that, and they're going to say, oh, yeah, my kid is ready, but... And right here, actually, here, Rob Bowman, Conservation Congress Chairman, says, I'm okay with lowering the age, but I'm not in favor of allowing two weapons between the two.
That makes sense.
So we're not alone in the way we're thinking on that. And it says the mentor must remain in arm's reach of the person for whom he or she's mentoring. So we'll get back after a few messages. We need to take a quick break, Brandon, and we'll be right back with some more Biggie Outdoor Radio. Welcome back to Biggie Outdoor Radio here, and we were just talking about this whole mentoring thing, Brandon, you know, and somebody in their article had actually made a comment that when there's one weapon between the two, one hunting device, weapon, bow, gun, whatever it is, that's actually mentoring.
Yeah, it's not mentoring when you both have a weapon.
That's right. You're teaching, you're working with them, you're showing them how to use it. I think that's the safest way. I also think that they do need to have a minimum age. I mean, you can't just say no minimum age. I think that's going to get way out of hand.
Yeah.
There's got to be, whether it's 8, whether it's 5, whether it's 6, I don't care. They've got to have a minimum age. What are you going to do? You're going to take out your 2-year-old and say, hey, you know, oh, my 2-year-old can handle it. Watch him. You know, well, I mean, it's going to get ridiculous.
Trying to push that, because if they take away the minimum age, they're going to argue it till they're blue in the face. You got to put a number to it. You have to put a number to the minimum.
Oh, heck, my boy's ready. Look at him. Look at him go.
He's 9 months old.
Oh, yeah. He came out of the womb with a Marlin 22 in his hand. No, I think that's going to get out of hand. Wisconsin does have rednecks.
Yep.
I don't want to say where, because the people of Adams County could get a little bit offended, but, you know.
Yeah.
So, anyway, let's talk about some upcoming weather things. You know what? The weather is getting cooler, Brandon, but not cold enough. You know, last year this time we already had ice on the water.
Yeah, we did. Yes, we did.
But I'm not going to complain, and I'm not going to try to jinx us.
Well, you know what? Now that you say that,
Yeah.
I'm ready to do some ice fishing.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
But let's remind everybody, if you're thinking about ice fishing, I know you're in a hurry. I see the ice shacks on people's lawns. I see people building new ice shacks. I know you want to go ice fishing. But please don't get in too big of a hurry, okay? You know, because as soon as the water freezes, we know that people are going to start falling through.
Because, happens every year?
Because what do? They're out there when the ice is clear because obviously the fish, I don't know what it is, but they think maybe it's real. Maybe it is. The fish bite the best when the ice is right.
First freeze.
Mm-hmm. So you always get those guys out there, you know, and they're poking the stick, boop, they're gone. And then some guy gets a medal for saving him. You know?
Oh, man.
We don't want to hand out any more medals, okay? So don't go out there.
Yeah.
You know, it's just very ignorant. Don't be doing it. Don't be going out there. Examine your gear. Get all your stuff ready. Take your time. Fix and adjust. Get some new line on your tip-ups. Tip-ups is the way I like to fish. You know, I like to sit in the shack, put the tip-ups out, have me a brewski, a line and kugel.
Oh, good Lord. Yeah. See, I actually like it when, you know, you get out there and if you got a few guys with you, you put in a certain amount of tip-ups and then you can sit there in the shack and jig. Right. I like the jigging, especially now we've been using the Vexlar the last couple of years. I know people have been using that for years.
You've been using a Vexlar?
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, I'm going to put that on my Christmas list. I want a Vexlar.
Really?
I want one of the good ones, though.
It ain't happening.
What the heck, man? I mean, I'm still your boy, ain't I?
Yeah, but you're not getting a Vexlar.
Hook me up, man. No. Come on.
No.
Oh, jeez.
I'll tell you what. I'll get you a night vision scope, and you can stick that down there and look around and see what you see.
Well, if you're going to get me a night vision scope, I'll accept that, too. That's fine.
A cheap one.
I don't want a cheap one.
Well, you get what you get.
Oh, man.
I'm saving my money for my grandkids that you're supposed to be working on.
Yeah. Speaking of which, we got to wrap this up. No, I'm just kidding. No.
So, you know, it says here, start with your big stuff. To check your shelters over, make sure the mice haven't chewed it all up and made some extra ventilation.
Make sure your beer cooler is well insulated.
There you go. Make sure your beer cooler is working. Check for loose screws and nuts.
Not including the one that's going to be fishing out of it.
Yeah, that doesn't. Yeah. That's right. Make sure your poles work. Lubricate them. Spray some WD-40 or some WD-50. Just kidding.
Huh.
Yeah, or some gun lubricant on there. That'll work, too. Some of that spray stuff.
Rem oil.
Rem oil, that'll work, yeah.
Yeah, buddy.
And attend your ice augers. Check your blades. Gosh darn, there's nothing worse than going out there and trying to drill a hole. Or what's even worse is when you're the guy that's over here trying to fish and some moron's over there trying to drill a hole with a dull auger.
I'll tell you what. My buddy's dad
sharpen that thing, boy.
He does the best job of sharpening the auger blades that I've ever seen.
Really?
I mean, seriously. Yeah.
Garrett's dad, now the auger is only 2 feet long.
Yeah. I mean, Garrett's dad, he can sharpen the heck out of an ice auger. And actually, last year, he just got one of them new them battery-powered or electric ones, whatever those are, the Ion. It's an expensive auger, but it's completely silent.
Really?
And it works damn good.
I wonder if it would work if you got one of them augers that worked off the front of a skid steer.
Oh, like a post hole digger.
Yeah. Just drop it in.
You going to drive your skid steer out on the ice?
No, but I'm saying somebody might.
You're crazy, man.
Yeah.
Well, now that you put that idea in somebody's head, we're going to read about that in the paper.
Get us a picture for Facebook and send it to us before you fall through. But anyway, you know, make sure your ice augers are all going. Check, pull it, start it, make sure it's working now. Hey, the weather's nice. Do this stuff now. Same with hanging your Christmas lights. Hang your Christmas lights. Get your ice auger working.
Are you trying to get me to help you with Christmas lights?
Yeah, that'd be nice.
Oh, yeah.
Fire up your electronics, your Vexlars, get all that stuff working, your sonar units.
If you had a Vexlar, if you got a dad who's nice enough to get you one for Christmas.
There you go. Check your heaters over, you know, get all that stuff ready. Take advantage of the weather that you have now. Get ready, but then wait
for good ice.
There's got to be at least an inch or two of ice before you try going out there.
I always wait until I see the second car on the ice. The first guy I figure is nuts. When I see the second car, I figure it's time, okay, I can walk out there now.
Oh.
When I see a whole city full of cars out there, then I'll drive. Yeah.
Even then, it's not quite safe.
Listen, let me tell you something.
To me a few years ago.
Yeah, I know.
My buddy dropped his truck through the lake.
Yeah, but it wasn't you, thank gosh.
No, I was right ahead of him. I think I broke it open for him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, organize your tackle boxes because, you know, there's one thing. Oh, you know, get your rusty hooks out of there. Get some sharp ones. Again, head on down to Chase Outdoors. I'm sure he's got some nice ice hooks for you down there and get some nice fresh
hooks. I'm sure he does, yeah.
You know, because there's nothing worse than a fish getting hooked with a rusty, dull hook, you know?
Why?
I don't know. I just would imagine the fish doesn't like it.
So. A hook is a hook. They're not going to like it either way.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, but at least you're thinking about them, you know?
Yeah. Well, yeah, you know, you don't want to have that big old, you know. So, hey, it says don't overlook your safety equipment. Make sure you got ice picks and a life jacket. I have never taken a life jacket ice fishing. Have you?
No. Once I put the beer in there, I don't have room.
Yeah?
Well, so, all right, you know, then.
Yeah.
We're throwing soda cans. Yeah.
So, a section of rope, a good ice chisel, and a spud bar.
A spud bar?
Yeah.
Why a spud bar?
It must be for checking the ice.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah, that makes sense. A spud bar.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what all these terms mean. I mean, when I go ice fishing, I mean, really, I'm just... I mean, take a couple of tip-ups, you know, couple tip-ups and, you know, a good 30-pack of Busch Light or something like that.
Or you can also use a spud bar for chiseling your hole out when your hole gets... When your hole gets... Froze shut. You ever had your hole froze shut? Don't look at me like that.
You know what makes a really good cooler in the ice? It's if you don't have a cooler with you,
what?
You take the ice auger and you drill about a half a hole out, and then you can put your beer down there and keep it nice and cold.
Huh.
Yeah.
We're not supposed to talk about beer.
Well, or your soda.
Or your canned beverages.
Your canned beverages, yeah. In my case, beer.
There you go.
Oh, man. Not supposed to do this. Not supposed to do that.
Yeah, this also makes a good place to keep your fish. Put your fish in there. Do you put your fish in with the beer?
Well, yeah.
Huh.
But usually it ends up getting...
Just make sure you don't drink too much and you pick up and try to drink a fish.
Yeah. What happened to you today? Kissed the northern right on the lips.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
On accident.
This time.
Oh, good Lord. Yeah.
So, anyhow, get yourself ready for ice fishing season. I see the people get ready, but don't get in a hurry. Okay. Don't be the first guy to drop your car through. Don't be the first guy to fall through. Let's not make a statistic out of you.
So you're telling people to be chickens?
No, I'm saying be careful out there.
Well, yeah, yes, be careful out there. But don't be afraid to be the first guy on the ice.
Report back. Tell us where they're biting and exactly where they're biting. Like, give us the coordinates.
Yeah, we'd like to know that.
Yeah,
absolutely.
We'd like to know exactly where they're biting. Okay?
All right. Thank you for that.
Yeah. All right. We'll take a quick break, Brandon.
Yep, and we'll see you at your lucky fishing spot.
All right. Be right back with some more Biggie Outdoor Radio.
Welcome back to Biggie Outdoor Radio. This segment is brought to you by Bruce Brothers, located on Highway X in Weston, just off of Highway 29. Fresh burger ground daily from Country Fresh Meats, and awesome hand-cut fries with all the tasty seasonings to choose from. They got plenty of tap brews with 35 beers on tap. If you haven't made your way on over to Bruce Brothers yet, you need to head on over and check them out. And tell them Big E sent you, and they'll give you a little something special from us just for mentioning it. But head on over there, and you'll be hooked up with the best burgers in town. That's Bruise Brothers on Highway X in Weston.
Hey, welcome back to some more Big E Outdoor Radio. And hey, you know what, Brandon? Assuming that it's some of these people are getting kind of cold out there.
Could happen.
We've had some cold years. We should probably talk about some ways to stay warm while you're out in the woods hunting. Now, you know, not everybody has a nice blind to hunt out of.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But you know, while we're touching on that, if you're looking for a blind, it's not too late to run out to Anawa.
Shed shop.
Head to the shed shop, see Denny out there, give him a call, go see Denny, listen for his ad, we get you the phone number, and you can get yourself a blind that you can put a nice little heater in it, hang your hammock in there, and you don't have to worry about getting cold anymore.
I need Denny to make me an ice fishing shack.
Well, you could use your hunting blind as an ice fishing shack and everything.
Yeah. Just put wheels on it, yeah.
You could move into it.
Oh.
It'd make a great place to go when the wife kicks you out. Doghouse, deer hunting blind, / ice shack. All from the shed shop. Go see Denny. Anna Juan, Shano. Big take care of you.
You could even put a porta potty in there.
No, you put the porta potty outside. You don't want that inside.
Oh, well, okay.
Okay. Yep. You definitely got to leave the shed to use the porta potty. So, but anyway, if you don't have a nice blind or a shed from the shed shop, let's talk about some ways that you can stay warm. One is...
Take your significant other with you, and you can snuggle in the blind.
That'll work. That would work.
Oh, that's not number one.
But you're not going to see many deer if you do that. But here's one. Put some cardboard underneath your feet.
Huh.
And that will help block out the cold that's coming from up underneath. Because the cold actually comes up burrowing through your boot soles. And that's supposed to be good down to negative 60 degrees. So you tear off strips of cardboard, stuff them in the cracks and holes of a box or blind, and then also just put them under your feet.
Actually, I know people, when we're ice fishing,
yeah,
that take cardboard with them, and they'll take and set that out there. If they're sitting on a bucket jigging or whatever, if they're not using a ice shack,
they sit on the cardboard.
They'll sit on the cardboard, yep. Keep their feet on the cardboard. They'll set their 5-gallon bucket on the cardboard, and they'll just sit there. And
so now you've got to use for cardboard. So when you get your wife that new refrigerator or that new vacuum cleaner for Christmas.
Do not tear it up. That makes a great fort.
There you go.
All right.
And make a good ice fishing jacket.
Yeah, yeah.
Says bring extra boots and blankets. You know, some people are just cold, prone to cold feet. You know what? Actually, an inexpensive pair of boot blankets. That's what they're saying. Use boot blankets, you know. But here's what I've done. I've actually taken my boots off and put them in blankets before.
Yeah.
Wrapped them up and actually kept them warmer that way than I have when they were in the boots.
You put your boots in a blanket?
No. I put my feet in the blanket.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, why do you keep your boots warm if you're going to take them off? You don't make any sense.
Sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
I know. Invest in heat packs. There you go. You could always do that. But then, you know, the thing is if you're going to put heat packs, you can put them in with your hands. But if you're going to put them in your boots, you're going to have boots that are a little too big for you.
Because
otherwise it gets kind of tight in there. You start shoving heat packs in there.
Yeah. You remember that... You could
put some jalapeno peppers down there. And see
Remember that year that you, me, and Mom, we were all sitting out in our stand at the Colburn Swamp. We had the heater cranking. We had this old quilt.
Yep.
And we started the thing on fire in the stand.
Yeah, that kept us warm.
Yeah, it kept us real warm.
Yeah. Yeah. Once the quilt started on fire, things got warm in a hurry.
That's right, yeah, yeah. So, and to touch on the heat packs, those don't do you much good if you're sitting in a pair of boxers at a Packer game.
No.
Yeah. Trust me, I've done it.
Yeah, that's right. But if you put a couple, it says put a couple around your midsection, it keeps your core warm. Now.
If that's what you want to call it.
Your core, your body. They also have those heated vests, you know.
Oh, yeah, I got me one of those still in the package.
Put the batteries in it or turn that thing on, or else you can just stuff them in your pockets of your vest or jacket and it'll keep you warm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'll work. Double up on hats, it says. So, yeah, you could put two hats on. Remember, your mom used to tell you that 80% of the heat loss went through your head.
Because I didn't have much up there.
Yeah, it's because it was all air.
Yeah, yeah.
So that doesn't mean you should go hatless when you're hunting in cold weather, because it's not true. It's It's not true.
It's not true?
No.
Well, what the heck?
But you still should.
You're saying that was a lie?
It's a lie.
Ugh.
But.
Man.
But you should keep your head warm, because once your brain freezes, you don't start thinking straight.
No, that brain freeze, that's a cold weather syndrome, according to my sister.
Cold, that's what happened.
Brain freeze.
Yeah.
Not what happened, that's what she thought was a... I mean,
right.
Well, it could have been what happened. I mean, yeah. We live in Wisconsin. Yeah. Yeah.
Hey. Eat the right food.
That's right, Flamin' Hot Cheetos, folks, that'll keep you warm in the blind.
That's... No, it says eat the right food.
Yeah, Flamin' Hot Cheetos.
It says you don't want to have spikes in your blood sugar. That can make you cold. So you want to have complex carbohydrates like nuts, seeds, these nuts.
Oh, good Lord.
Fruits, vegetables, eat protein-rich beans, unprocessed
meats. I know every time I go hunting with you, I'm hunting with a big old fruit.
And avoid things like bread crackers and candy or anything high in saturated or trans fats. Well, there you go. That's why we're cold all the time. I'm eating a Snickers bar all the time.
And sandwiches.
Sandwich.
Bread, crackers, cheese and crackers. I have that in the blind all the time.
We need
candy.
To eat nuts, seeds, fruits, and vegetables.
I'm not a bird, all right?
And beans.
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 Yeah, that's good in the blind.
Beans.
Yeah.
Well, heck, that
load up on warm. Beans. Yep. Yeah, all right.
Just think of that. Then wrap a blanket around you and your buddy and keep yourself warm.
Wait, you and your buddy?
Well.
I don't know. See, the last couple of years, I mean, during deer season, I haven't really, you know, hunted with you necessarily enough. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So maybe I don't understand. You might be going a different way with this, but I'm not going to share a blanket with my buddy.
You might be. No. I could be your buddy.
Yeah, no. Not happening, man.
Hey.
That's just...
Well, there's another thing it says, is drink hot water.
Yeah. A lot of people want, you know, hot cocoa or coffee or whatever. What's wrong with hot water?
Yeah.
Hot water will warm you up.
Yeah.
That's right.
The hotter, the better. The hotter it is, the warm, more it'll warm you up, especially your tongue.
That's how heat works. The hotter it is, the more it'll warm you up.
And it'll help you keep hydration away, because you can get dehydrated in the cold.
Actually, if you drink cold water, it shocks your system a lot more.
It does.
It does. Yeah, if you drink room temperature water, especially like in the summertime when you drink room temperature water, it does better for you.
Really?
But yeah.
Oh, that's good to know. I'm glad you know all these things about water.
Well, I don't know all these
things. What if you drink fermented water?
Fermented water? Well, I don't know. You ever seen a koala bear eating a fermented fruit?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. They get all stoned and fall out of the tree, you know?
Huh.
Sitting there drunk in the road in the middle of the night.
Hey, buddy.
Yeah, he ain't your buddy. He will tear you up when you walk up to him. He's got two thumbs and two fingers, and they work like a little claw, you know? We were just talking to somebody about that this last week. I can't remember who it was, but he was talking about a koala.
It was Jan from Three Lakes.
Yeah, that's
Trophy
right.
Ranch.
Yeah. He's playing with a stone koala bear in the middle of the road.
Stone on eucalyptus.
Eucalyptus, yeah.
Well.
Or whatever that is.
Anyway.
Why do we get so off track?
I don't know. What is wrong? Stay away from being dehydrated. Drink plenty of water, some hot chocolate. Don't put peppermint in it. That's not a good thing to do. Stay away from the alcohol. That's not going to help you.
Whatever.
It just makes you think you're warm and you're not. Mm-hmm. And then you run around in your boxers at a Packer game.
Well, oh, man. Why you got to call me out all of a sudden, throw me under the bus? Well, I mean, Jesus almighty. Yeah. Yeah, and don't eat things like, you know, bread, crackers, candy, all that. No. In fact, I'll give you an address. You send that to me. I'll eat it for you. Oh, yeah.
So make sure you stay warm while you're out there. Don't get cold. Don't get frostbite. And keep your extremities covered. Your ears, watch out for that stuff. If you start feeling cold, don't be afraid to go warm up.
Watch out for ears?
Yeah, be careful that your ears don't get cold.
Oh, yeah.
Like if you're, especially the guys that wear ball caps while they're out there hunting and their ears are exposed. And then the next thing you know, the tips of their ears get frostbit. And then they look like Mike Tyson took a bite out of them.
Well, you got to pick on Mike.
There's got to be some other ways that we can tell people that they should stay warm. But, you know, here's the thing. If you're sitting in a stand or a blind, you can take a blanket or a sleeping bag or something like that, or a heater bodysuit.
Ooh, yeah.
Them are good.
I'm going to tell you, the heater bodysuit does work. You can get that, again, at Chase Outdoors. Mm-hmm. Something you can use. I mean, a heater bodysuit will keep you warm. You crawl inside of that thing, you pull it up around you, and it just pops down real easy when it's time to shoot.
Yep. But it's a lot more expensive than a blanket.
Yeah.
Just take a blanket with you.
Well, I know, but a heater bodysuit's made for that. So,
okay,
but a blanket will work, a sleeping bag will work.
Yep. Or just hunt from the truck and turn the heater on.
That'll work. Put a good heater in. Make sure if you're using a heater inside of an enclosed stand that you're well ventilated, because we don't want to need anybody that's getting carbon dioxide out there and they end up.
Yeah, crack a window or something.
Yeah, we don't need anybody tipping over. All right, I think that we covered just about everything we can think of for ways people can stay warm. So hopefully. Hopefully that helped a little bit. If you got any other ideas, hey, hit us up on Facebook. We always love to hear your ideas.
Yeah.
And we'll be right back. We're going to take another quick break, and we'll be back and wrap up this hour of Big E Outdoor Radio. Thanks for listening. Hey, welcome back to Big E Outdoor Radio. We're wrapping up our second hour here, Brandon. And, we're in the middle of, well, we're not really in the middle of the gun deer season, but we're into the gun deer season. And, for the most part, it's the end of the second day, which is kind of the end of the big hurrah.
Mm-hmm.
Opening weekend, which is what is the big thing for everybody. Prior to the season here, we're talking middle of last week, the Department of Natural Resources was kind of down a little bit on their, they weren't looking for the best of seasons. Number one, looking at last year's numbers for gun deer licenses, they only sold just a hair under 610,000 gun deer licenses last year. And that was the fewest licenses that they've sold since 1976. The record was almost 700,000 in 1990. Now, in 2014, hunters only harvested 222,600 deer. That's the smallest harvest in 31 years. Now, it's 100% the DNR's fault.
Yeah.
On this. It's because of all the tags. It's because of the whole eradication. It's because of all the doe tags. It's because of all the crap that they've done. And they brought in the wolves.
Yeah.
You know, I understand it's not their fault that the wolves are now on the endangered list, but they're the ones that brought them in. So, we're going to get to that in a second. As of Tuesday, hunters purchased
392,138 licenses.
Right. So it's kind of pretty close to what they had last year.
At this time last year, yeah.
At this time.
So,
yeah.
They still got to sell, almost 220,000 more licenses. To match last year's total,
which is still low, yeah.
Yeah.
And then why are hunters not hunting anymore? Well, I was a diehard hunter. I haven't bought a gun license in a lot of years. I stopped because there's nothing here to hunt.
Yeah.
You stopped.
Yeah.
I mean, when we stop hunting here, we're starting to go to other places because Wisconsin has killed the deer season.
Mm-hmm.
And so, they're trying to promote deer season and trying to promote, improving the deer habitat. And they're still kind of hoping that the hunters are procrastinating and they're going to come out and start buying at the last minute. But I got news for them. I'll bet you that when they total up the numbers that they're down again. And it's probably going to be lower than last year. Because, there's people that have been hunting all their lives, but, think about back in the 70s, deer hunting was so important, schools would shut down. They don't hunt anymore. They penalize kids for taking off. Okay, so they've kind of taken that tradition out of it. So now that the kids aren't getting into it like they used to,
yeah.
They've ruined the herd. The herd's gone.
And you even look at places of work, too. I mean, where I work, I was talking to one of the supervisors out there. They said they used to allow for third shift employees on Friday night.
Mm-hmm.
If you brought in your hunting license and showed them, if you busted your butt and got the work done, they would let you go at 4 o'clock instead of working until 7. They'd let you go at 4 o'clock so you could get out there to your deer stand. Now they don't do that because the people who didn't hunt, they thought it was unfair. And plus on top of it, they're talking about, you know, this is the time of year where you get a lot of mandatory Saturdays where you got to work.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of takes the spirit out of it for people. You know, you don't get to hunt opening weekend. Well, okay. Yeah. Well, what the heck?
Yeah, if you don't get to hunt opening weekend, to be honest with you, you might as well just forget it, you know. You know, and here's the thing. In 12 northern counties where they're trying to rebuild the herd, where they're saying the herd was thinned by harsh winters and predators such as wolves. In other words, they're admitting that the wolves have taken an effect on us.
Yep.
They have eliminated doe tags, antlerless tags. Okay, well, you know what? They should have cut them darn antlerless tags down a long time ago.
Yeah.
They should have been down to one.
We need an antler restriction.
You know.
That's what I think.
And the other thing is it doesn't look like hunters are going to venture out as much because they don't have a lot of snow. And they're not going to see to track the deer.
They are talking about snow on Saturday, though.
Yeah, yeah. So, which, again, we're pre-recording this, so, again, we don't know what the weather's actually going to be like. We've probably got some snow.
Yeah.
But it's not like it could be. It's not like it could be. You know,
it's not like it's been in the past.
The deer are more abundant in the western part of the state, the southern part of the state, the central part, obviously, where they got a lot of cropland, you know. And, but again, then what they're doing there, all hunters get an antlerless tag with their license. So what's going to happen is eventually down there, then they're going to have no deer down there pretty soon. I mean, they got to quit shooting all these does. Guess what? Every time you shoot a doe, you're killing two more deer for next year.
Yeah.
Multiply that out, you're killing four more deer over the next 2 years.
Yeah.
If one of them funds as a doe. I mean, it's ridiculous. So there's a lack of interest in hunting. Access to land is one. People can't get at the land. Landowners are getting to be more and more picky, they're fighting with each other, everybody's locking things down, which is, you know, again, we come in, you got to post your land and things like that, but landowners don't work together anymore. You know, it's like everybody owns 10 acres, you know, the big tracts of land, and they're gone, and this everybody split it up, and every Tom, Dick, and Harry owns land, and what it is we've allowed a lot of these people to come from the big cities from out of the state, you know, not naming anything but Chicago. They come up here, and they buy land, and they buy 10 acres, and they think they own the world.
Yeah, yeah.
So people have just given up. They're sick of it, you know, sick of fighting. And, yeah, there's public property. What are you going to do, go hunt the Colburn and get attacked by wolves?
Yeah.
Obviously, if there's that many wolves out in the Colburn Swamp, there ain't any deer out there anymore.
Well, yeah, that's just it, you know. And,
yeah.
And hunting public property, especially during rifle season, is dangerous as it is. I mean, when the sun comes up in the morning and you can count 30 lumps of blaze orange sitting in the trees around you,
yeah,
I want to get the heck out of there.
He says other hunters don't see the deer because they don't spend enough time in the woods and they give up. Hey, let me tell you something. These hunters are spending the same amount of time in the woods in the morning as they always have. But what's happening is now when they sit out there and by noon, they haven't seen any deer run by them where they used to see a dozen or maybe 20 deer by that time.
Yeah,
they're giving up. Think about it, their DNR, that's why they're giving up. You have killed all the deer. And they say, you know what, screw it, I'm going home. I'm going to go home and watch the Packer game or watch the game. I'm going to go home and snuggle with my wife. Why am I going to sit out here when there's no deer? You know, 10 years ago I would sit out here and I'd have seen 15, 20 deer by now. Now there's nothing.
Yeah. Of course, we might have more hunters sitting in the woods on Sunday. You know, they might not want to go and watch the Packer game given the losing streak we're on.
Yeah, well, yeah, well, that's another topic right there. You know, they're saying not everybody's a dyed-in-the-wool hunter, you know, whatever. They can blame it on all they want, but what they're doing here is they are looking for excuses to try to come up with why the hunting is down. The hunting's down because you killed all the deer. You killed them off with stupidity and too many tags.
Greed.
And giving in to the what, to the insurance companies or whatever the reason was. You went after the federal money with the stupid CWD thing.
Yeah.
And again, I'm not jumping on the game wardens themselves here. I'm talking about the politics, the people in the bureaucrats in the DNR. They went after all this CWD garbage. You know, let me tell you something. They've been messing with the CWD thing for 35, 40 years in Colorado. If they haven't figured it out yet, what makes you think that the people in Madison are smart enough to figure it out? Hello?
Yeah.
It's not going to be figured out. So just forget it. It's a natural thing. You got a better chance of curing cancer, so why don't you go look for that? You know?
Yeah, look for something that actually affects people.
Why don't you go worry about curing cancer or HIV or something like that? Because you know what? That affects people. This whole CWD thing is a waste of money. You started it because you were looking for federal aid. All these states are getting into it. Just drop it. It's ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
It's out there. The deer have it. They all have it. They all can get it. Some will, some won't. Forget it. You're wasting our money. You could be spending that money in a lot better places. And if you weren't blowing all that money on CWD, some of you guys might have some better trucks to drive around in. You know?
Yeah.
So, you know, like I said, if they wouldn't have went and whacked all them deer, I mean, how many people have we talked to that quit hunting because of all that eradication zone? They gave it up. They're not hunting in Wisconsin anymore. They're so ticked off.
Yeah, heck, just in the last month, we've talked to several people. I mean, probably 10 or 12 people who have given up on that. You know,
they said we're not going to hunt in
Wisconsin. It's frustrating. Anymore. It's frustrating, yeah.
They're pretty much boycotting Wisconsin hunting because of that.
Yeah.
They said if that's the way Wisconsin wanted to be, they're not coming back. That's why your numbers are dying. It ain't because they're not dying the wool hunters. It's because we're going other places, guys. We're going places where there are animals.
You want to fix it? It's up to Wisconsin to fix it.
That's right.
So,
yeah. All right, with that, we're going to take a break, and we're going to come back with a brand new hour of Big E Outdoor Radio. We'll be right back.